Check.
Test. Well, good morning, everyone. Good morning, and welcome to Fulford United Methodist Church, where we are bringing the love of God through Jesus Christ to a world in need. My name is Nathan. I'm the pastor here, and it's great to have all of you here and worship with us this morning. I invite you to take a moment, read through the bulletin to see what we're up to here in the life of our congregation, where it is where you can get to know each other a little better and grow in your fellowship, but of course where it is also that you can grow in your discipleship as a follower of Jesus Christ. We've got a couple of new things that are in the bulletin that I want to point your attention to. The first is that tomorrow night will be our second of three movies that we're showing this summer. That'll be God's Not Dead at 6:30 here in the sanctuary. That's totally free, so just come. There'll be some light refreshments. We'd love to have you come here and be part of that fellowship and to watch this movie with one another. There's also information there about our back-to-school event at Walmart, where we partner with the Kiwanis Club and with the Optimist Club, and we need volunteers to help out with that, so there's details about that. There's also information about Pokemon Go, so if you're a player, we are a site, and so there are details about that in the bulletin. As well as fantasy football that will be forming a league again at the end of August. So there's all types of fun stuff, not to mention, of course, you know, Bible studies and that type of thing as well, right? So those are all involved. All those details are in the bulletin of how it is, again, that you can continue to grow as a disciple of Jesus Christ. I'm going to invite forward, I can't see because it's right out there, Heather Rose, who's from the Bloodmobile. She's going to share just briefly about that. So come on down, Heather. Grab your mic. I think it's not on the back. It's on the front. You got it. Just go.
My name is Heather. I work with One Blood. We are the blood bank here in South Florida. We provide blood to many, many hospitals in South Florida, actually in Florida entirely, in South Carolina, Alabama, and Georgia. When your friends and your family are in a hospital and they need blood, we are the ones that go out in the street. We are your lifelines. We are your friends and your family. We are your neighbors, and we are the ones that spread the word to everybody and let everybody know that they are in need. And today I come to you and I beg you for help. I have many people in need in hospitals. I have children, I have mothers, and I have fathers that they need your help. I need you guys to please take a few moments of your day, walk to my blood mobile, and help me out with a blood donation. It's one pint of blood. You have approximately 10 to 12, and I just need you to share one. one with somebody who really needs you. Your donation can potentially save 3 lives, and that could be the life of somebody you know. So I beg you guys to please take a moment of your time, walk to my blood mobile, and help us out with a blood donation. Many of you may be scared. Many of you may have never done it before, but I can personally tell you, I do it every single time that I can, every 2 months religiously, and I save many, many lives. The emotional gratification of knowing that I helped somebody and I gave somebody an extra day of life, to me, moved mountains. And I wish you guys to please take a moment of your time to experience that feeling, especially on a beautiful day like today. If you have any questions, please ask us. We are here to help you and educate you. But more than anything, we are here to hold your hand and enjoy this process together of saving a life. So please help us out today. We really need your help.
All right. Thank you, Heather. Thank you for that invitation. So the blood mobile is right outside here in the parking lot next to the sanctuary. If you're interested in donating, please, if you want to stay for the service, that's fantastic. They'll be here after service. But if you'd like to do it also during the service, they can go ahead and donate and come back in. So please feel free to go ahead and do that if you feel so called. Thank you, Heather. So take some time to read through the bulletin. Also this morning, take some time to fill out the friendship sheet that lets us know that you were here and worship with us today. If you're visiting with us today, welcome to our congregation. We're happy to have you here with us. That information allows us to be able to follow up with you later in the week. There's a place on the friendship sheet that also has a place for your prayers so that our prayer team and others can be lifting you up in prayer if you have something you'd like us to know about. And then on the back of the friendship sheet is the place where you can indicate if you have any questions about any of our ministries or programs or things that are going on here in the life of the church. When the offering plate comes by later in the service, you can put that friendship sheet in the offering plate, and we will do our best to try to follow up with you later in the week. Finally, if you haven't had the opportunity yet, let's take just a moment to welcome one another to worship. If you would go ahead and extend a hand or a wave or a smile to the folks that are sitting around you to give them a proper welcome here to the life of our church. Now I invite you, as you make your way back to your seat, if you made a journey, you can go ahead and stand up. We're going to start our time of worship together with song by lifting our voices together with our praise song. Let us sing to our God.
Bless the Lord, O my soul, O my soul. Worship his holy name. Sing like never before, oh my soul, I worship your holy name. The sun comes up, it's a new day dawning. It's time to sing your song again. Whatever may pass and whatever life before me, let me be singing when the evening comes. Bless the Lord, O my soul, O my soul. Worship his holy name. Sing like never before, oh my soul, I worship your holy name. You're rich in love and you're so to wind. Your name is great and your heart is kind. For all your goodness I will keep on singing. 10,000 reasons for my heart to find. Bless the Lord, O my soul, O my soul. Worship his holy name. Sing like never before, O my soul, I worship your holy name. still my soul, we'll sing your praise unending. 10,000 years and then forevermore. Bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul. Worship his holy name. Sing like never before, oh my soul. I worship your holy name. Bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul. Worship his holy name. Sing like never before, oh my soul. I worship your holy name. Yes, I will worship your holy name. Lord, I worship your holy name. More power, more of you in my life. More love, more power, more of you in my life. And I will worship you with all my heart. And I will worship you with all of my mind. And I will worship you with all of my strength. For you are my Lord. More love, more power, more of you in my life. More love, more power, more of you in my life. And I will worship you with all of my heart. And I will worship you with all of my mind. And I will worship you with all of my strength. For you are my Lord. You are my Lord.
Good morning, church.
Good morning.
God said it, I believe it, that settles it.
Amen.
Our call to worship. Your word, O God, is a lamp to our feet and a light to our journey. When everything around us is dark and we can see no light at all,
may the light of your word show us the way to go.
When the future is uncertain and we can't see what lies ahead, may the life from your word show us the way to go. When we feel abandoned and betrayed and have no one to turn to, may the life from your word show us the way to go. When we are tempted to do what we know is wrong, may the life from your word show us the way to go. Open our eyes to see the wonderful truths in our word, in your word. Give us understanding that we may keep your law and put it into practice in our lives. And we worship you today and always. Amen.
Good morning. What a beautiful South Florida morning. Amen. I invite you, if you'd like to see the music also, turn to page 389. The words will be projected freely, freely. How about the beautiful cross this morning, huh? See anything new? It matches. Methodism, huh? To forgive my sin in Jesus' name, I've been born again in
proclamation of faith. Do we believe?
Yes.
We do believe. While some follow fad and fashion, changing with the seasons in Paris, London, and New York, we follow the man from Nazareth. While some put their hopes in a big lotto win or chase profits, at no matter what cost to family, we put our hope in loving one another as our Christ has loved us. While some may give into a sophisticated cynicism, or some fall into apathy or despair, we put our faith in the God who has given us his only true Son. While some may boast of their superior education, culture, race, or living standard, we boast in the self-giving that's done on a cross. While some try to justify themselves by prizing fame or power, or by claiming superior morals, we allow the grace of our Lord Jesus to be our best prize. Because of Jesus, yes, we believe in the living God, by whose Holy Spirit all things are open to change and renewal. And that includes us and the church. Thanks be to God. Amen.
You may be seated. At this time, I want to invite forward Crenton Douglas and Isabel Saitu and their son, Crenton Douglas. Is he a junior? Yes, Crenton Douglas Jr. And I want to invite all of you to turn in your hymnal to page 33. We have the privilege of celebrating the sacrament of holy baptism this morning. So, anybody who wants to come up? Whomever you'd like. Yeah. This is Crenton Douglas and Isabel Saitu and their son, Crenton Douglas Jr. They're joined up here by grandparents and godparents and other friends and family, and we're excited to have them here to celebrate this sacrament of baptism with Crenton today. Friends, through the sacrament of baptism, we are initiated into Christ's holy church. We are incorporated into God's mighty acts of salvation and given new birth through water and the Spirit. And friends, all of this is a gift that is offered from God freely for each of us. And indeed, it is my pleasure to present to all of you Crenton Amari Douglas for the sacrament of baptism. So on behalf of the church, I ask his parents these questions. Do you renounce the spiritual forces of wickedness, reject the evil powers of this world, and repent of your sin? And do you accept the freedom and the power that God gives you to resist evil, injustice, and oppression in whatever forms they present themselves? And do you confess Jesus Christ as your Savior, put your whole trust in his grace, and promise to serve him as your Lord in union with the church which Christ has opened to people of all ages, nations, and races? And finally, will you nurture this child in Christ's holy church, that by your teaching and example he may be guided to accept God's grace for himself, to profess his faith openly, and to lead a Christian life? All right, and two questions for you, church. Your responses are on the next page, which is page 35. I ask you, as Christ's body, the church, do you reaffirm both your rejection of sin and your commitment to Christ? And will you nurture one another in the Christian faith and life and include these persons, all of them, before you now in your care? With God's help, we will proclaim the good news and live according to the example of Christ. We will surround these persons with a community of love and forgiveness, that they may grow in their trust of God and be found in their service to others. We will pray for them that they may be true disciples who walk in the way that leads to life. Amen. Hey, you ready, Quentin? Hey, buddy. Here, let's make sure mom and dad can see, okay? Hey. Quentin Amari Douglas, Jr., I baptize you in the name of the Father, in the name of the Son, and in the name of the Holy Spirit. May you grow to be a faithful, faithful disciple of our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. 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 Friends, let us welcome our newest brother into the body of Christ. Here's mom and dad. You did great, buddy. Alrighty. Quentin and Isabella will be at the back, most likely, if you want to welcome them to the life of our congregation and congratulate them on Quentin's baptism. I'm sure they would be thrilled to meet each of you. Welcome, guys. Congratulations. Absolutely. As they are making their way back to their seats, it's time for our children's moment. So I want to invite forward any children that want to come on down for this morning's children's moment. Good morning, boys and girls. How are you today? Good. You guys awake? Barely. What? I was here last time. Can I tell you a secret? If you come every Sunday morning, almost every Sunday morning, guess who's going to be here? Me. That's true. Right? And a lot of these people. But I'm here almost every Sunday. Another secret, if you come like on Monday or Tuesday or Wednesday or Thursday, not usually Fridays or Saturdays, guess who's going to be here? Yeah, me. I'm here a lot. It seems like I'm here always time, right? Yeah, like it's my job or something, right? Oh, yeah, that's right. It is. But sometimes I like to take trips. And sometimes I like to go to Disney World. Have any of you ever been to Disney World? You've been to Disney World before? Was it fun? Yeah? You went somewhere like Disney World? Legoland. Okay. Cool. For your birthday, you're going to go to Legoland? That's exciting stuff. All right, so I have a question. I was thinking that I'd like to go back to Disney World sometime, because I haven't been to all the parks yet, because I'm from Ohio, right? So I didn't get to go to parks when I was a kid, not to Disney World parks. I'm going to other parks. But there's two football teams for Ohio. They're not very good. But there are two football teams. Yeah, my dad raised me as a Browns fan. We'll talk about that later. But I have a question. If I were going to try to get to Disney World, could you guys give me directions on how to get there?
No.
Nobody?
Nope. You could use a GPS.
I could use a GPS, right? Or what? Or a map. Or what?
A computer.
Okay.
A phone.
Yep. I could call Mickey and be like, Mickey, I'm in Miami. How do I get to you?
No.
Is that what you're saying? Call the manager of Disney World. And they'll tell me how to get there. Are there any other tools that we might be able to use to get there? What are you saying?
A map?
Okay, I heard a phone. Listen to God so he can tell you where to go. I like it. Yes, sir. Oh, okay. There's no subway in Florida. We'd be underwater. But I like how you're thinking. There's this old tool that has been kind of made new that's on some phones. You guys ever heard of a compass?
Oh, a compass!
Yeah, you guys ever heard of that?
Yeah!
Now, someone told me that Disney World is about northwest from here, okay? So, without looking, which direction would that be, northwest? You have any idea? You think it's about that way? How about anybody else? Maybe forward. Well, I'm going to tell you where everything is in a second. We're in the southeast of the country. All right, so Disney World should be northwest. Do you guys want to see if the adults know where northwest is?
No.
I bet some of them do.
I
All right, adults, can you point the northwest?
Yeah.
It's that way, right? So if you look here, come here, ladies. So you can see a compass points where north is. That's where that red arrow is. And there's west on the left. And so it's going to be right in between there. So they were right, right? Northwest is back that way. So
I said that.
You did. Good job. Yeah, if I just started walking, I'd probably end up in a swamp somewhere. But in theory, we could walk that way, and eventually we'd be a lot closer to Disney World than we are right now, right? Especially if we went that way, because we're going to take a long time to get to Disney World that way.
That's
east. That's right. Right, you'd have to go all the way around the world, right? So we have tools like a compass, or we could have used another app and used GPS, right, to give us the directions so that we could go exactly there. Or we could use a map, like set on the end. Or we could take a plane and let somebody else figure out how to get there, right? Exactly. So we have all these tools. Not necessarily. But we have all these tools that we can use to help give us directions or to help guide us. Do you know there's another tool that's kind of like that, but it's for our life? Does anybody know what that is?
Yeah.
What? What's a tool that God gives us to give us direction, to tell us how we might be able to guide ourselves?
By keeping people safe from that can kill people.
That's true. That's one of the ways that we need to live our lives. But there's a tool that helps give us directions.
The Bible.
That's right. Right.
You were just talking.
I was trying to give you a hint. All right. So in this Bible, when we open up its pages, we find out lots of things about God and how God wants us to live our lives. And ultimately, what we discover and what Jesus tells us, what I'm going to share with the adults in a couple of minutes, is that Jesus tells us that we're supposed to love God and that we're supposed to love one another. And that is our direction for our life. So sometimes, like you said, that means that we have to help protect other people, because that's a way of showing them the love of God. And so here's what I want you to do this week. How many of you have a Bible at home? All right, so some of you have a Bible. Those of you who have a Bible, if you're able to read, I want you to take some time and read through the Bible. And what I think would be really great is if you take the Bible and you read with your parents or whoever brought you this week, that you just spend some time reading with them. If you don't have a Bible, perhaps your parents do, or perhaps maybe your grandparents or somebody else. And if you don't have a Bible at all and you need one, come and talk to me and we will get you a Bible. And if you're saying, well, Pastor Nathan, I don't know how to read quite yet, that's okay. What I want you to do is to go to your mom or dad or your grandparents and say, hey, I want to know what this book says. Can you take some time to read some of it with me? Because when we read the Bible, and it's a big book, it's going to take you a while. It's going to take you a long time. But as we read this Bible, we find out that God loves us. And we find out how it is that God wants us to love God and how God wants us to treat each other. And it's like a compass, or a GPS, or a map that helps to guide us and to give us directions for how it is to live our life. All right, I gotta wrap up. That's right, you are the ray, the truth, and the life. That's right, good job. All right, can you guys gather around, let's pray. Come on closer. All right, let's bow our heads and close our eyes. Oh, gracious and holy God, we give you thanks that you love us and that you have revealed yourself. You've told us how much it is that you love us and how to live our lives in this book of the Bible and through your son, Jesus Christ. Help us to be able to study the Bible and to know what's in there, but more importantly, how to live that out each of our lives, to love you more, God, and to love each other so that we're following the compass, the way, the path that you have for us. We love you, God, and we thank you that you love us. And everybody said,
amen.
Amen. All right, boys and girls. I believe there is junior church. The Doyles are that way, and nursery is staffed as well. So if you are in elementary school, you can head over that way with the Doyles. If you need to go to the nursery, that is available as well behind us. Thank you, boys and girls. And as they make their way to their seats, we'll continue as soon as I can get myself up here in our worship service with the sharing of our joys and our concerns as we prepare to go to God in prayer this morning. So, Fulford, what are your joys? What are your concerns? What do we need to lift up today? Yeah, Justin? Yes, you do. If you're going to share the good news, I think you already do.
Hello, everybody.
So if you've watched the news or have anyone under the age of 30 in your household, you know what Pokemon Go is. It's an app. Our church is a Pokestop. Some of you are like, oh, this is nonsense. Well, on Friday night, we had 22 people stop by our church who had never come to our church before, only because we provided a lure at our Pokestop. So we're doing that again this Friday from 8 to 10. You don't have to show up, but pray for it. We had people stop by, people park, come on in, hang out with us for a couple hours. It was great. In a very diverse group, from 40 to 18, couples, singles, it was great, and even kids. So you can pray for that. We're not sure if we're calling it a ministry or not.
Sure.
But it's a great outreach for us, and providing a really safe area in our area for people to come and participate in that game. So please keep that in your prayers. Thank you.
Thank you, Justin. Yeah, absolutely. As we talk about today, sharing the love of God with people, offering hospitality and opening our doors and providing food for folks in a nice, cool, air-conditioned space is absolutely ministry and is sharing the love with folks of God. Are there other joys or concerns this morning? One more time, Trish.
Pray for the people of Nice.
Yes,
and
absolutely.
For the people in Turkey.
Turkey.
All the upheavals that are going on. And for both of the conventions that will be going on this summer.
Absolutely. Yes. Joyce.
Well, I'm Joy. I would like your help and pray for a member of my family is in critical condition. And I want him to bring him in Miami. And if anybody can help, it would be appreciated. Thank you.
All right, thank you, Joyce.
We pray for Kathy.
Okay.
She is in heaven.
Yes. We continue to remember Kathy, who's in heaven, absolutely.
We pray for her.
Yep. We pray for her and thank her for all the great work she did. It is that. Thank you, Amanda. Nancy.
Good morning, everyone. I want to thank everyone for praying for my husband. He's feeling better. He still has a pain. We can't figure out why, but they're running more tests later on for that. And pray for the food pantry. I had to cancel it last time because I didn't have any food, because Feeding South Florida is having problems with their computers, and they couldn't provide me with food this month. So keep them in your prayers that they get back up and running. I do have food. They gave me food this last Thursday, but keep us in your prayers for that. Thank you.
All right. Thank you, Nancy. That's
you, Linda. I spoke with Terry this week. I don't know who else spoke with her, but Alan is still in a lot of pain, but they are planning a trip to Mississippi this week.
Okay.
She's going to be driving, so prayer for her.
All right. Lifted up Terry and Alan. Alan's still in a lot of pain. They're headed over to Mississippi, so we'll keep them in our prayers as they make that trip. Are there silent concerns? Hold on a second before we get to that. Yeah, Lynn.
Please pray for me to make the right decision, you know, when I make a choice about my shoulder, because
okay.
I need surgery.
Continue to lift up Lynn in prayer as she decides and discerns whether or not to have her surgery on her shoulder. Are there silent concerns that you'd like to have recognized this morning with the lifting of a hand? All right, friends, in just a moment, we'll take time and go to our Lord in prayer. At the conclusion of our prayer, we'll lift up the prayer that Christians have been saying for centuries, which is the Lord's Prayer. Before we do that, though, I do want to ask you that you be in prayer for our community. As a church, we're in a little bit of a time of transition. Staff Parish had to come to a difficult decision a couple of weeks ago to let our music director, Mark Henschel, go. There were some events that had happened that we decided we needed to come to that decision. So we are in a bit of a transition with our music ministry program. I can't go into any further details about exactly what happened, but do want to let you know that that has occurred. We are in the process of then finding who will replace Mark, or if it's more than one person. And so we had asked that you would be in prayer for that. We will have conversations and give you opportunities to help give us some feedback as to what type of leader and music that we'd like to do as we move forward. So you'll hear more details about how to give us some of that feedback. Of course, my email is in the bulletin, so you can always email me or call me if you want to give me that direct feedback, but we'll also have other ways to be able to receive that information as well. The joy part of our transition is that our intern that we've talked about, Myron Rhodes, along with his wife Annette and their granddaughter Alexis, arrived safely here in South Florida on Friday evening. Myron is here today with us in worship. He begins officially in mid-August, so he's just here worshiping with us today to check us out. But you can give him a proper welcome, so I'm going to ask him to stand. Myron is here. Go ahead, Myron. We're very excited to have Myron with us. He comes to us from Arkansas via Perkins School of Theology in Dallas, and he's finishing up his Master's of Divinity with this year-long internship with us. Some of you have asked exactly what he will be doing. We've got some ideas about what that is, and then some of that we'll figure out as we go along. But it's going to be great, and we're blessed to have him and Annette with us for these 9 months together. So welcome, Myron. Excited to have you and see what God's got in store for your ministry here. Invite us now, friends. Let us go together to our God in prayer. Would you join me now in an attitude of prayer this morning? Oh, Heavenly God, we are not altogether convinced that darkness is a thing of the past. Many people in this world of ours feel their world is one of darkness and gloom, oh God. Pressures crowd in upon us and they get us down. We know that the causes are varied. For some of us, it's bereavement or illness. Others, it's money or worries about family or trouble at work or not having work. Some of us struggle with drugs or with drink or with boredom or doubt or weariness or futility. And then, oh God, then there are the world's issues as well. War, poverty, climate change, disease, unfair trade, and really, Lord, the list goes on and on and on. It does not help when we feel that as Christians we should be doing so much better than we are. Oh, gracious and loving God, we know we rejoice. We rejoice that you are with us in our troubles and that you know us and that you love us always. And so even though we have made a mess of things personally and collectively, oh God, you remain faithful. We rejoice, though. We rejoice that your Son came not to a perfect world, oh God, but to a broken world, to our broken world, to bring light to the darkness, which so oftentimes is our darkness. And so we pray. We pray for our dark and dreary world, a world that is in need. In need not just of a technical fix, oh God, but in need of love and grace, forgiveness and new life, hope, peace and fellowship, in need of renewal, oh God, in need of you. So we pray. We pray that you would come alongside us and all those for whom we pray, that you would show us Jesus, the light of the world, the one who came and continues to come to rid us of sin, to give us life and health and peace, a peace that passes all understanding, not just a temporary respite from trouble, but the strength to overcome it and ultimately to receive life eternal. Holy God, we know that you don't wave a magic wand for everything to be sorted instantly. Instead, oh God, you require us to exercise our faith and to respond to your call to preach the gospel and to seek to live it out, to look to you for the strength that we need to share your love and your grace. So help us. Help us to share the good news and word and action that indeed there is a Savior, a merciful King who loves us and whom we can love and adore and who is revealed in the Bible and in the world continuously. For indeed, we have been set free. So enable us to use our freedom to share in bringing in the kingdom. In the light of this, we have something to celebrate, something to shout about. For even in our trouble and pain, even in our loss, we know that Jesus is with us. So hear us, oh God. Hear us as in a moment of silence, we pray for those that are in darkness, whatever kind that might be. Let us pray that they may see and know the light of Christ. Indeed, the Lord is our light and our salvation. So, Lord, hear our prayers, spoken and unspoken, and answer them for Jesus' sake. In the name of our cornerstone, we pray and we lift up this prayer, joining now our voices with all the voices that have gone before us as we say together, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Friends, we continue in our time of worship this morning with the collection of our tithes and our offerings. If our ushers would please come forward as we give back to God what God has first given and entrusted to us.
It was so good.
may be seated. I'm going to invite forward Tia Linda, who's going to read for us our gospel message. Come on up, Tia Linda.
Our scripture comes to us today from the Gospel of Matthew, chapter 5, 17 through 20. Do not think that I have come to abolish the law or the prophets. I have come not to abolish, but to fulfill. For truly I tell you, until heaven and earth pass away, not one letter, not one stroke of a letter will pass from the law until it is accomplished. Therefore, whoever breaks one of the least of these commandments and teaches others to do the same will be called least in the kingdom of heaven. But whoever does them and teaches them will be called great in the kingdom of heaven. For I tell you, unless your righteousness exceeds that of the scribes and Pharisees, you will never enter the kingdom of heaven. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
You can spend your whole life building something from nothing. One storm can come and blow it all away. Build it anyway. You can chase a dream that seems so out of reach, and you know it might not ever come your way. Dream. Sometimes life ain't good, and when I pray, it doesn't always turn out like I think it should, but I do it anyway. I do it anyway. This world's gone crazy, and it's hard to believe that tomorrow will be better than today. Believe it anyway. You can love someone with all your heart for all the right reasons, and in a moment they can choose to walk away. Love. Tomorrow they'll forget you ever sang. Sing it anyway. Yeah, sing it anyway. Yeah, yeah. I sing, I dream, I love anyway.
So I don't know about you, but I get to the end of that song when Martina McBride, after having spent the whole song talking about the truth, really, that we can dream and we can love and we can build and we can work and we can believe, and oftentimes what we're hoping for and dreaming for and trying to build or work towards doesn't turn out the way that we want, but yet she gets to the end of the song and she belts out, I sing, I dream, I love anyways. Even though she knows and even though we know that things don't always work out the way that we hope or dream or plan or work towards, we are still called to sing and to dream and to love. That as followers of Jesus Christ, even when we look around and we go, whoa, what is going on? Christ still calls us to love God and to love one another. If you catch me listening to this song in my office, or you happen to come to my house at some point and you hear me listening to it, or if we went for a run and I had it on my earbuds, if you were to hear me with this song, you could safely assume that usually when I listen to this song, which is part of the reason I'm sharing it with you today, it is as an act of encouragement. To try to encourage myself, because I've either looked around and gone, oh my goodness, is it making a difference? Is getting up on Sunday morning and talking to folks every week about how to love God, is it making a difference in their lives? Or is our love as following Jesus Christ, when we look at the news, is it making a difference? If we get discouraged, we can hear this message from God that tells us to love anyway. To look around and continue to love, and that absolutely it is making a difference, and it does matter that God is working through us. Today, as we continue in our sermon series on half-truths, looking at things that so oftentimes we just assume come from the Bible, that are just, we assume are part of our walk as Christians, what we are doing is really continuing our conversation from last week. Last week we gathered after the shooting of young African-Americans and of police officers and of other acts of violence, and we came and we lamented, but really we had a larger conversation also about how is it that God is working in the world. And it was through the response of the half-truth that everything happens for a reason. And what we said is that God is working in this world. And what we see is that God most often isn't working, whereas God has created everything and that everything has been put into motion, that God steps back and says, you guys are left to your own. No, that's not how we often see times God's working. And we said it's not the other end of the spectrum where God has said, I know every single thing and I'm controlling every single thought and action and everything that happens in the world. But instead we said most often, yes, God can operate in those ways. But most often the way that God is working in the world is through you and through me, through the body of Christ. Through the way that we love God and the way that we love one another. We said the good news is that as we are doing that, God is present and God is working and is moving, that in every place of pain and hurt and violence and of death itself, God is there working through us to bring life. Today we do continue in the sermon series with this look at the Bible and with this question of how is it that we are called to read the Bible, and therefore how is it that we are called to live our lives. And when we do this, what we see is that we are called to read scripture and to lead our life through the lens of Jesus, to do what he did, and to do what he tells us to do. I'm not the most argumentative person. I don't mind a good debate, and I will do that with you if you'd like, but I usually will let you leave thinking whatever you'd like, unless I have done the prep work ahead of time for a particular thing that I'm really, really passionate about. A couple of you have experienced that. Usually I'm pretty flexible, right? And usually I'll take input and we can change things and have a conversation. So you might not want to take this advice, but I'm going to give you some advice for how to win an argument, or at least how to stop an argument. Now your first clue should be it's the title of the sermon, and we're calling it a half-truth. But nevertheless, here's how you stop an argument, right? So you're talking to somebody, maybe it's just about politics, right? Everyone seems to be talking about that a lot. Or maybe it's about morals. Or maybe it's just a conversation about sports. You know, it's inconsequential. Who's better, LeBron or Michael? Whatever the case might be, right? If you can get the argument to where you're ended up talking about some type of scripture, okay? Just pick the Bible and find a scripture that you think proves your point. And then if you will tell that person, God said it, I believe it, that settles it, you will have won your argument. Now, I don't know if you have a relationship still with that person, But if you want to end the conversation, that's a great way to do it. God said it. I believe it. That settles it, right? Because what you're really telling the person is, look, God said it. And of course, God says, I think God says, and I believe that, of course. And that settles the argument. So stop the conversation. We're done. Now, frankly, that is what we call a half-truth. There's some truth in that. There's a whole lot of good news that isn't involved in that statement. And really what this idea of God said it, I believe it, that settles it, usually when people are saying that, what they're referring to is the Bible. And what they're saying is that the Word of God or the Bible says it, so therefore if it's in the Bible, then I believe it and that settles it. But we spent 3 months as a congregation in January, in February, and March, and I know not everybody was here for part of that, but that's okay. But we spent a long time talking about the complexities of the Bible. Right? And we know as a people that the Bible has been used in ways that would make all of us ashamed in the past, where other people have said, it says it in the Bible, therefore I believe it, and that settles it. Times when our scriptures has been used to justify slavery or putting women in their right place, whatever that awful statement means, or for violence, or for war in the name of God. We look at the news and we wonder sometimes how other people could do such atrocious things in the name of God, and we forget that Christians before us and possibly even ourselves do atrocious things in the name of the God. Oftentimes because we say, God said it, I believe it, that settles it. But what Hamilton talks about, and I wholeheartedly agree with him, is the way that we are called to look at the Bible more fully and more truly is to do so through the lens of Jesus. How did Jesus look at the law? How did Jesus interpret the prophets? What did Jesus do and what did Jesus say? And what we see quickly in our text today, Jesus is delivering the Sermon on the Mount, the core teachings of what it means to be part of the kingdom of God. And it begins with what we call the Beatitudes, which often are the blessed are these, or the happy are these, depending on your translation. And what we see automatically is like, look, if you have assumptions of what life in the kingdom of God is going to look like, Jesus says, I've got some ideas for you. Blessed are those who mourn. Blessed are the peacemakers. Blessed are the merciful, the gentle, those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, those who are persecuted, those who are persecuted for me. We see right away that Jesus is interpreting again what it means to be blessed. And I don't know about you, but I look at those Beatitudes and go, whoa, blessed, happy are the people that do these things. Jesus continues on in the chapter and he says, you are the light of the world. In the prayer today, we talked about God being the light of the world, Christ coming into the world as the light of the world, as it says in the Gospel of John in the beginning. But as people that have received that light, we are called then to go and to share that light, to be the salt of the earth, Jesus says. And then we get this passage that frankly can be a little bit difficult, right? Where Jesus says, look, I haven't come to abolish the law. So just in case you think I'm going to take the law, and he's referring to the Torah, the first five books of our Old Testament scriptures. I haven't come to get rid of that. I haven't come to get rid of what the prophets did, but instead I have come to fulfill the law. And then he goes on and talks about it. And in a society where we like to talk about conservative and liberal a lot, and we like to put people into categories, Jesus right away could be labeled as a conservative in these first couple of verses. Because after the passage of the scripture that Tia Linda read for us today, Jesus does some interpretation, which should tell us that if we go around saying all the time, that settles it, that's the end of the conversation, Jesus said, no, look, I'm doing some interpretation myself of the Torah, of the prophets. Because what Jesus says in verse 21, and he's going to say it several more times, is you have heard it said, and then he goes and he quotes the Torah, or he quotes some of the other rabbis, he quotes Moses, and then Jesus says, but I tell you this. Jesus is doing what we call exegesis or hermeneutics. Those are fancy theological seminary words. He's interpreting scripture. He says, you have heard, and he does this with a couple of topics, right? You have heard that you shouldn't murder, but I tell you that if you get angry, it's like you murdered somebody. Whoa, Jesus, the law was like this, and you made it like this. Like even more stricter. You have heard that you shouldn't commit adultery with someone, but I tell you that if you lust after somebody, you have committed adultery. You have heard that you shouldn't take an unfaithful oath, but I tell you that if you take any oath, that you shouldn't have done that. I tell you that you shouldn't seek revenge unless somebody has hurt you, but you need to turn the other cheek. You have heard it said that you should love your neighbor, but I tell you that you should love your enemy as well. Right? It is like looking at Jesus and going, whoa, Jesus, I thought the Torah said it, and I believed that, and that settled it, but now you have come, and you're reinterpreting it, and you're making it harder, Jesus, because that is hard stuff that Jesus is talking about. But part of what we are doing when we talk about how it is we interpret Scripture and read Scripture and how that means then that we should live our lives is doing what Jesus said and doing what Jesus did, which is good news, because right now what Jesus has said, woo, this is hard stuff, guys. But thankfully, when it comes to God, we also talk about grace, right? Because what did Jesus do? He talks about adultery, and he talks about divorce and what that looks like in the Sermon on the Mount. He makes it even harder, frankly. But then when he is approached and a woman is brought to him, has been caught in the act of committing adultery, and people want him to make a judgment, the law said that she could be stoned for doing that. Jesus instead kneels down, writes something in the dirt, and turns to the crowd that is gathered around and says, let one of you without sin be the first one to throw that stone. And when Jesus meets a woman at the well in the Gospel of John who has had five different husbands, he tells her through a conversation, reveals to her who he is and the good news of what that means, and then he tells her to stand up and to sin no more and to go on her way. She becomes like one of the first evangelists because she goes back to her community and tells everybody. We do what Jesus did and what Jesus said to do. And we know what Jesus said to do, right, church? Jesus is given the opportunity in Matthew's gospel and Luke's gospel and in the gospel of Mark. It's in those synoptic gospels we call them. Where a Pharisee who is called a lawyer, not like we think about, but someone who would have known the law, the Torah, an expert in that, approaches Jesus, trying to trap Jesus, but maybe also sincerely wanting to know Jesus' opinion, Jesus' interpretation, and says, what is the first commandment? And Jesus replies back, as would have probably been the expectation, to love the Lord your God with all of your heart and with all of your soul and with all your mind, your might. There every being, but like a good preacher, Jesus adds on to it, right? Right? Jesus responds back, oh, let me give you the second one too while I have your attention. The second one is like it. Love your neighbor like you love yourself. And then he says, all the other commandments hang or rest upon these two. Jesus is telling us, look, if you want to read Scripture or how you live your life, the filter or the lens that you lead it through or you live it through is through loving God and through loving one another. And like we talked about last week, the way then that God is working and moving in the world when all their pain and violence is happening, right? When we hear that song and it talks about singing and dreaming and loving, right? Despite the fact that something terrible happened again in France. And despite whatever this coup thing that's happening in Turkey or whatever pain might be happening in your life right now, that we are called continually to love God and to love one another and to trust that God is working through us in that love. And so then we are called to read our scriptures and to live our life through the lens of Jesus, of loving God and loving one another. Jesus says in verses 17 through 20, the text that Tia Linda read, he says, I haven't come to abolish the law. So this, you know the law, you know the Torah, you know what the prophet said. I haven't come to get rid of that, but instead to fulfill it. And what I think that Jesus is saying is that through my life, Jesus is saying, through my life, through the way that I love and I'm teaching you to love God and to love one another, that this is how the commandments are fulfilled. We've shared it in Bible study before and discussed it on Monday evenings, that Jesus basically just sums up the Ten Commandments. The first four commandments or so are commandments about our relationship with God. Do these things or don't do these things, and you have a good relationship with God. The rest of the commandments, like, you know, don't steal or commit adultery or kill somebody, if you don't do those things, you'll probably have a better relationship with your neighbor. And so Jesus summarizes them up and says, love God, love one another. And as I have done this perfectly, I have fulfilled the law. And so we are called to do the same. That even when we look around, even when we are exhausted, even when we're scared at the implications, because sometimes it's risky, like we've talked about, we are called to continue to love, to grow in our love of God and to love one another. One of the conversations that I've had several times in the last couple of weeks is the debate, and it has been a good conversation, but the debate or the conversation about, man, has our world really gotten worse? Are worse things really happening, or are we just more aware of it because of our technology? And I don't know if the debate has been settled, but Anne Lamott has a voice to add to the conversation, and I want to read a little bit of what she said on one of her Facebook posts. She's an author and quite insightful. She writes this: life has always been this scary here. And we have always been as vulnerable as kittens. There's an image for you, right? She says, plagues and Visigoths, snakes and schizophrenia. Cain is still killing Abel. And nature means that everyone dies. I hate this. It's too horrible for words. When my son was 7 and found out that he and I would not die at the exact same second, he said, crying, if I had known this, I wouldn't have agreed to be born. Don't you feel like that sometimes? My father's mother lost a small child in the 1918 flu pandemic. Someone in the family is having a nervous breakdown. A yoga teacher was shot down the road last year by some druggies while walking on a footpath. A yoga teacher. And then in recent weeks, Orlando, police shooting innocent people, and innocent police officers being shot. And now Nice, this was written before Turkey on Friday, so we could add that as well. How on earth do we respond? When we are stunned and scared and overwhelmed to the point of almost disbelieving. I wish there was an 800 number where we could call to find out, so I could pass this along to my worried Sunday school kids, but no. Yet, in the meantime, I know that we must respond. We must respond with a show of force equal to the violence and the tragedies with love force, mercy force, unnegotiated compassion force, crazy caregiving to the poor and suffering, including ourselves. And so when we talk about what does it look like to love in our everyday life, she gives some great examples. Listen to this, church. She says, patience with a deeply irritating, provocative mother. $2 bills to the extremely annoying guy at the intersection who you think maybe could be working or is going to spend your money on beer. Jesus didn't ask the blind man what he was going to look at after he restored the man's sight. He just gave hope and sight. He just healed. To whom can you give hope and sight today? Ask yourself that. To whom can you give hope and sight to today? What about to me and disappointing old you? Radical self-care, healthy food, patience in a friendly tone of voice, lotions on the jiggly things, we'll leave that alone, forgiving pants, lots of sunscreen and snacks, maybe the random magazine. Do you have your last computer on the shelf that you really don't have time or effort to take to the after-school program in your town or in your church? Crislin, raise your hand. It's the branch's director there, if you have one of those old computers, all right, or something else you can help with. She says, are you going to do it today? She says, oh, go flirt with the oldest people at the market and tell them that you are glad to see them. Rala, hope and sight. Remember the guys in the Bible whose friend was paralyzed but couldn't get in close to see Jesus preach and heal? So they carried him on a cot, climbed the roof, and lowered him down for the healing. Can a few of you band together just for today and carry someone to the healing, to the Zendo, to a meeting? Help a neighbor who is going under. Maybe band together to haul their junk to the dump. Shop for sales for canned food drives at the local temple or the mosque or our church. How about 3 anonymous acts of kindness today? She concludes with this. There is no healing in pretending that this bizarre, violent stuff is not going on, and that there is some cute bumper sticker silver lining. It's fine if you want to believe this, but for the love of God, please keep it to yourself. It will just tense us all up. What is true is that the world has always been this way. People have always been this way. Grace always bats last. What a provocative image. Grace always bats last. It just does. And finally, when all is said and done and the dust settles, which it does, love is sovereign here. Love is sovereign here. Jesus says those who break or don't keep even one little iota, is the Greek translation, one little small part of making a letter of the law, are going to be considered least in the kingdom of God. But if you follow the law and you teach the law, you're going to be great in the kingdom of God. Now, frankly, I just want to be in the kingdom of God. I'm not much concerned whether I'm considered least or great. But what I think it shares with us is that as we are leading our lives and reading scripture through the lens of Jesus and what he did and said, which was to love God and to love one another, what we are beginning to experience is the kingdom of God breaking in all around us in everyday, ordinary exchanges that we have with one another and with God. And so, yes, there is pain and there is hurt and there is sorrow and there is death around us in our world. But there's also a God who is a God of life, who says, I am there in every situation, working through my people to bring life. And so we are encouraged to keep on singing, to keep on dreaming, and to keep on loving anyway. So may we sing, may we dream, may we love, and let us do it anyway. Let's pray together. Oh, gracious and holy God, we give you a thanks for your love that we experience, that you loved us first. That even as we get discouraged, or even when we disengage, or we're apathetic, or frankly, even when we are causing the pain in our own lives or in the lives of others, that you don't leave us, that you haven't abandoned us, that you are working and present with us and through us. So we offer encouragement, oh God, give us encouragement, strengthen us, reach out your hand of grace again and lift us up so that we might stand and boldly proclaim by the way that we live our lives that indeed we will sing and we will dream and we will love and look forward to the day when we will be fully in your kingdom. Where that pain and hurt and isolation and violence and war and poverty and racism and every other sin will no longer be anymore. That you will have wiped them away as you have wiped away our tears and you will dwell with us. Lord, we look forward to that day, but know there is work to do in the meantime. So help us to dream, to sing and to love anyway, knowing that you're singing and you've sung the best song already through your son Jesus Christ in his life and death and resurrection. We offer this prayer to you, God, through the power of your son and through the presence of the Holy Spirit that is with us. As your children, we lift our voices together and we say, amen. I invite you, friends, if you're able, let us stand together. We'll conclude our time of worship this morning with our hymn of dedication. It'll be number 356, When We Are Living. This is a song that is both in English and in Spanish. We'll sing the first two verses in English, and then we'll repeat those two verses, but sing them in Spanish.
Okay, all of you Spanish speakers out there.
We are fruits must give. God works of service are for offering. When we are giving or when receiving, we belong to God. We belong to God.
Friends, it's been great to have you here in worship at Fulford United Methodist Church, where we are bringing the love of God through Jesus Christ to a world in need. We want to give a special thanks to Lauren and Debbie and our choir as they led us in music today. Special shout out to Lauren and Jeff Arsenault, as well as Frank Pomley, for replacing, or rather fixing, our cross. We came in last Monday and the cross was on the ground. And so they refurbished it, rehung it, polished it, and added awesome lights to it. Those lights will change as our liturgical season changes. We're excited to have that and excited that you were part of worship today. I invite you now to hear our benediction this morning. Friends, may you go from this place today and always continuing to grow in your love of God and your love for one another, and to do so no matter what else is going on around you, knowing that God has already shown you how much you are loved by coming here as Jesus Christ and living and dying and rising again, so that me and you and all of creation might have life and have it abundantly. So go from this place as you seek to dream and to sing and to love anyway, knowing that as you do so, the Holy Spirit goes with you. Go in peace, friends. Amen. Thank you.
spend your whole life building something from nothing. One storm can come and blow it all away. Build it anyway. You can chase a dream that seems so out of reach, and you know it might not ever come your way. Dream it anyway. God is great, but sometimes life ain't good, and when I pray, it doesn't should, but I do it anyway. I do it anyway. This world's gone crazy, and it's hard to believe that tomorrow will be better than today. It anyway. You can love someone with all your heart for all the right reasons, and in a moment they can choose to walk away. Love them anyway. God is great, but sometimes love. That tomorrow they'll forget you ever sang.